Hi, I'm Trooper Charles Asher, the Pennsylvania State Police, sitting on stage at the Tower Theater in Philadelphia, talking to Mr. Frank Zappa, composer, musician, and independent thinker. Frank, could you tell us a little bit about your current tour?
Well, started February 2nd, and it's going to go until June the 9th. And the first half is in the United States, and the second half is going to be in Europe. So we're in the U.S. till March 25th, and then we start Europe April 9th, and then we go till June 9th.
Will you be doing the tour by yourself at the larger venues, or will you be adding another band?
Nassau is going to have Hot Tuna as the opening act. Mm-hmm. But I'll tell you about the opening act that we tried to get in Philadelphia. I can tell you now, kind of blows your thing for the... No, I'll tell you now. You know, I wanted to have for an opening act in Philadelphia? War of the Mummers. We tried to get warring mummer factions to march through the audience as our opening act at the Spectrum, and the Mummers have sadly declined. It could have been a great spectacle, but the Mummers didn't want to have anything to do with it.
What's the name of your tour?
Called Broadway the Hard Way. And I think mummery belongs, you know.
Could you run through the current lineup? Who's in the band?
It's Ike Willis, who is guitar and vocals, and Mike Keneally, who is the stunt guitar player and stunt vocalist, Walt Fowler on trumpet, Bruce Fowler on trombone, Paul Carman on alto sax and baritone sax, Albert Wing on tenor, Kurt McGettrick on bass sax and E-flat contrabass clarinet, Chad Wackerman on drums, Ed Mann on percussion, Robert Martin on keyboards and vocals, and Scott Tunis on bass.
That's 12 musicians, including yourself. The cost must be staggering to put a band like that together.
Staggering is a very good word, Chuck. It is truly staggering. Yes, it is. But then on the other hand, we're interested in doing something different than other people, so why not stagger a little bit?
What equipment are you using on this tour? Anything different than your 84 tour?
We have a synclavier, which is sitting in the background there. That's kind of different.
Same guitar you're using and same amplifiers and so forth?
That stuff's still the same.
You've been recording for over 20 years with over 50 albums released. What factor do you consider the most important in your longevity?
The audience. Without them, then you don't have any longevity at all.
I love Zappa. He's a Zappa. I like him. He's Zappa. Why not?
Did you audition your band members like you normally do for this current tour?
Yep.
Well, how about someone like Ike Willis that has been with your band for many years? Did he also audition?
No, I mean, Ike's a veteran. He's 10 years. I think Bobby has been in the band 7, Chad 8. Scott 8. Ed has been in and out, 5 or 6 years.
Well, for example, this Mike Cornelius.
Keneally.
Keneally, that plays stunt guitar. How many individuals audition for a job like that?
Not many. That's a hard chair to fill. I mean, basically, his job is to play all the parts that Steve Vai would have been playing on the 82 tour. And he was... We auditioned 2 guys, and he was by far the best.
How much rehearsal was involved in preparing your band for the road?
This 4 tour? Months.
4 months? Is that practicing every day, rehearsing every day?
No, for the first 2 months, it was anywhere from 2 to 3 days a week, and then for the last 2 months, it was anywhere from 4 to 5 days a week. Because we had to build the rehearsal schedule around the recording schedule of all the different guys in the band. They all had other jobs.
You're 47. Do you still enjoy the road touring?
I like playing. I don't like traveling very much.
Mm-hmm. The way radio is being programmed today, is there still hope for rock and roll music?
Well, I'm sure there's some people listening to the radio today that think that it's just fine, and other people who have stopped listening to it altogether because they think it's boring. Radio varies from city to city. For example, New York City, which has really excellent television. I mean, where else can you get Channel J, Manhattan Cable? I mean, truly cable excellence. They have incredibly boring radio. There are other cities in the United States that have much better radio, and you would think that a major metropolitan area would have the best, but no. You know, it varies greatly. And I stopped listening to the radio a long time ago.
You've been anti-drug in both your music and interviews. What got you interested into talking about that?
Well, people kept asking me because it started off that when I began recording, people thought my records were so weird that there was only one way that I could have possibly done those records, and they presumed erroneously that all the material was the result of a drug-modified imagination, when in fact, that's not true, you know.
I noticed that drugs still seem to be prevalent at rock concerts, and young adults have told me that drugs actually enhance their enjoyment of the show. Why do you think that is?
Well, I think that they have been convinced of that by a society that actually kind of makes drugs keep going, you know. The two things happen. Young people feel like they're under pressure and they want to escape from the pressure. They need somebody to cut them some slack. Their parents are not cutting them any slack. Usually the police don't cut them any slack either. I'm, no offense intended.
None taken.
The schools certainly don't, you know, and kids get the feeling like, oh my God, you know, what do? I want to have a good time and I want to feel like a human being, but everybody is hurting me. They're doing things to me that I don't like. And so that drives them to use alcohol, to use drugs, or to do other things which will just give them momentary relief. Now, the idea that drugs will make you a cool person is something that has kind of been perpetuated by the media. You know, I think it's a myth. Basically what happens is if you use drugs and alcohol too, you take these substances and you are no longer in control of your own behavior. And some people think of this as a license to be an a**. So you can always say, well, you know, sorry I ran into your car, sorry I killed you, but I was stoned, you know. Well, that just don't get it. You know, you to be precise, I believe you have a right to do anything you want to your own body, because you own your body, okay? You want to commit suicide? You think that's a good idea? Go ahead. You own your own body. You want to take drugs? Fine. Do it. You own your own body, so long as you know what the risks are. Here's where the line gets drawn. At the point where you, under the influence of these substances, become a liability to the society or a threat to the people around you, no. You can only do this stuff if you take the responsibility for what you're doing to yourself. It doesn't get it to say I was stoned and that makes it okay to be an ass. It just doesn't get it.
Do you think that drugs are a part, we had talked about drugs in rock and roll, do you think drugs are a part of all types of music?
Well, drugs are everywhere, America being what it is. I mean, take a look at our nation's capital. You know, plenty of drugs there. You go to a concert in Washington, D.C., it may not smell the same as a concert in New York City. And the difference is they're using drugs that don't produce an aroma. You know, but the drugs are there. They're everywhere. Judges use them. Politicians use them. Lawyers use them. Doctors use them. They're every place. Your mom's probably using them, as I've said before. She goes to the doctor. She gets a prescription. They're everywhere. For people to point their finger at kids and say, look at those teenagers using those drugs, some of the people who are pointing their finger probably are using drugs.
Have you ever taken drugs?
Sure. Excuse me, I'm gonna, here comes my coffee. Yeah. As I've stated before in other interviews, in fact, one yesterday, I've smoked a total of 10 marijuana cigarettes in my life. That was, I think, the last time that I had any connection with it was maybe 15 years ago. And people would have, because I like to smoke, and people would hand me these things and they would say, yeah, smoke this, you'll really get high. But what happened was I got a sore throat and it made me sleepy, and I never could understand why people enjoyed marijuana. But today I can't even stand the smell of it. Never taken LSD, no cocaine, you know, none of the big bad things. But you know, you want an example of the evils of drugs? Tipper Gore said she smoked one marijuana cigarette. Look what it did to her.
Do you drink alcohol?
Yeah, I like wine with food, but I don't go out and drink to get drunk.
What do you do if you're at a party and people are using drugs? Does that make you uncomfortable?
I don't go. I don't want to be around them. First of all, the legal risk for a person who says the things that I do is too extreme. I don't want to be anywhere in the vicinity of somebody possessing drugs. No way. And the other thing is, I don't like to look at people and the way they behave when they're under the influence of drugs or alcohol. I see enough when I watch the news on television. You know, I don't want to see them live in person at a party.
Lately, I think a lot has been said about your anti-drug stance. Do people, for instance, at rock concerts still offer you drugs, knowing or possibly knowing that you don't take them or use them?
Well, in 84, there were kids still throwing joints onto the stage and stuff like that, and I just kick them off to the side. But so far, on this tour, we haven't had any of it.
I saw your Baby Snakes video, the three-hour video, mm-hmm. and there were a couple instances in the video where you actually mentioned, you know, during the concert that type of substance is bad for you.
This guy came up to the edge of the stage, and I guess he had some, I don't think you call it a bong, some big paraphernalia with a hose coming out of it, and he wanted to give me a little snort on the end of the hose, and I told him, that stuff is very bad for you, take it away.
Okay. That stuff is very bad for you, throw it away. Okay. Now you're interrupting my story, now listen. What is that? Is that the Tower of Power or what? Oh no, no, it's one of those dope fiend devices. Take it away.
No, I've never been shy about telling the audience that, but it is not my job to go on stage and preach to them about what they do to themselves. I believe if you know what the stuff can do to you, and the key here is knowing what it can do to you, that's an educational problem, then I think that every American, everybody, has a right to control their own destiny, to control their own body. They do not have the right to harm other people as the result of their habits or lack of responsibility. So I don't feel that it's my job to act like artificial dad and, you know, enforce it. I mean, I can tell them what I think, but beyond that, it's a matter of individual choice.
What is the number one reason, in your mind, why people use drugs?
Hopelessness. I mean, without hopelessness, why would you want to hurt your body? You know, if you didn't feel that I got nothing to lose by doing this, then why would you do it? Now, where does the hopelessness come from? It comes from the family, which is disintegrating. It comes from the government, which is disintegrating. And it comes from the schools, which are disintegrating. Hopelessness is the result of social disintegration. It seems pretty simple to me. You want people to stop using drugs? Then change the reason why people use them in the first place. It doesn't make any difference how many shipments of cocaine you interdict, because there's going to be another one coming in. Economies of whole nations in South America depend on cocaine. You know, they're not going to stop making it because they're feeding their children by selling cocaine. They're going to keep shipping it out as long as somebody in this country wants to use it. Same thing with marijuana. You don't want people to use drugs? Then take away the reason why they hurt themselves.
Moving right along with hopelessness as an answer, this year our country will be electing a new president. And I noticed last night at the show in Philadelphia, you had a booth set up in the lobby in conjunction with the League of Women Voters that encouraged, you know, concert goers to register to vote. But what made you get involved in this?
I started getting involved in it in 1971 when the 26th Amendment, which gives the 18-year-olds the right to vote, was passed. If you look at the Fillmore East album, 1971, you'll see in the bottom it says, don't forget to register to vote. Now, it wasn't easy to get the 26th Amendment. There's probably a lot of kids looking at this that don't know what the draft means. Once upon a time, the United States government had the right to snatch you off the street and make you go off to die someplace for who knows what. They could just say, you, go die, okay? And if you were 18, they could snatch you when you were 18, but you couldn't vote and say, no, I don't want to go do that. So it took a lot of effort to get the 26th Amendment to allow 18-year-olds the right to vote. In other words, if they're going to make you die, you should at least have the right to vote to say who's going to be your elected officials. Since the time it was passed, very few 18-year-olds have taken advantage of this right to vote. Believe it or not, even at 18, you can make major decisions like in your local area, which bond issues will get passed, which taxes will be levied, whether or not money will be provided for schools, whether or not certain local officials who you may know from firsthand experience are not trustworthy, whether or not they will get in and in some way infringe on your rights. You have the right to decide who's going to be the president of the United States. You have the right to decide who your congressman is going to be, who your senator is going to be. That's a right. It's not a privilege. It's your right. So what I tell them is, if you don't register, you can't vote, and if you don't vote, democracy doesn't work. And so I must presume that you think democracy is a good idea. So you should register and you should take advantage of this wonderful thing called democracy. Remember, the Reagan administration thinks that it's such a great thing, this democracy, that they want to export it to Central America. Well, my theory is, before they send it someplace else, let's get it here and use it here. You know what I mean? Couldn't hurt.
Is the 18 to 25 age group the largest unregistered block of voters? Do you know?
It probably is, but I don't have the exact statistics. I would say that in terms of voter apathy, it runs rampant in that age bracket, especially the closer you get to 18, because kids are more interested in having a good time than worrying about the future. But I must say that this is really something important. If you don't take an interest in your country, that means that while you're out listening to the Beastie Boys and fighting for your right to party, some person who does not have your best interests at heart is going to vote in your place, and you're going to wind up with somebody telling you what to do, and you won't like it. So get in there.
A couple months ago, went into I think it was a Kmart or a Sears to purchase one of your albums, and was told flatly by the sales clerk that they did not put your records in their store. They did not stock your records, and I just asked the person why, and they did not really comment. What can I do? I don't want to have to go to a little store on the side to purchase a Frank Zappa album. What can I do to ensure that I can get the quality entertainment that I want to get without having to go through a 15 or 20 mile drive to go to a store that I know will have it?
That's very simple. You dial 818-PUMPKIN and get it mail order. The reason we have the mail order business is because certain socially retarded areas will not stock my records, even though the most recent ones have been entirely instrumental. There couldn't be anything offensive on there. It's all music, you know. So I would really call that censorship on the part of Kmart. But if you want to get a hold of the albums, dial 818-PUMPKIN, and they'll either tell you where the nearest store is in your area to pick it up, or you can order it direct mail order.
What can Frank Zappa fans look forward to, audio and video-wise, in the next couple months or next year?
Next album to come out is called Guitar. It's a double LP, has 80 minutes of music in it, and it's all guitar solos. It's the follow-up to Shut Up and Play Your Guitar, and that's due out in a few weeks. And then after that is the first installment of You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore.
Has any of your band members used drugs on the road, to your knowledge?
Oh, yes, they have, and they've also been fired.
How would you convince a personal friend to stop drug use?
Well, since they don't have any personal friends, that is a difficult question, Chuck. But you could just suggest to them that certain things that they're doing to themselves might be ruinous, not just harmful to them, but ruinous to their health.
I'd like you to comment on this statement that a high school student wrote: I'm very happy and satisfied with my feelings. Drugs allow me to rise above all my troubles and day-to-day lifestyle. Why should I give up that which brings some light into my day or my week? It is my power. Bring me something more powerful that enhances and enlightens me, and until you can do that, I shall have drugs as my power.
Well, there's something to be said for that attitude, so long as that person doesn't drive a car under the influence of that power, or that person doesn't grow up to be a brain surgeon under the influence of that power, or even a legislator under the influence of that power. Everybody's looking for a little slack here. And I don't know what the situation, the family situation is of that kid, and obviously it's not that terrific, or that person wouldn't be looking for the escape route.
With several releases on your Honker Home video, will you be moving away from music?
No, there'll always be something to do with music, but there'll be a few things oriented a little bit more toward talking. I mean, I think that there's a market for tapes of just plain conversation, if the conversation is interesting enough.
You mentioned to me a video project dealing with a Philadelphia family that became totally involved with the mummers. Could you share that with our viewers?
Well, once upon a time, see, I've always thought the mummers were terrific, but believe it or not, folks, outside of the state of Pennsylvania, most people don't know what a mummer is. I talk about mummers in other interviews and they go, huh, duh, what? So I had this idea about a movie. In fact, I had this idea in 1968 and I actually talked to Peter Boyle about being in it. But you know, all my movie ideas don't have enough money to do them. But picture this, okay? You got this, a big mummer, I mean the master mummer of Philadelphia, from a family that is the essence of mummer tradition here. They're so into it, they have their own private sequin mine in the backyard, and all the small children are lowered down nightly by a rope with a bucket and a little hammer into the backyard, even when it's snowing, to go down in the hole and chip these little magenta sequins off the edge of the sequin mine so that the costumes for these mummers will be the best. So this is their big secret, is their mine in the backyard. And the big mummer has got this teenage son who's not into mummery at all. You know, probably a Beastie Boys fan, thinks that mummery as well is for other people, not for me. So suddenly the big mummer gets a heart attack and on his deathbed begs his disinterested eldest son to carry on the mummer tradition in the household. It's this big conflict, you know, because the kid really, he really hates mummer music a lot. I mean, I'm looking over a four-leaf clover, give me a break, Dad. So they have this touching little conversation, and finally the big mummer gets the kid to agree that he'll carry on the tradition, and he doesn't know what to do. I mean, he thinks that if he's going to do mummery, he wants to bring it into the 20th century. But how to do it? And to make a long story short, he teaches the mummer band how to play Purple Haze. And they march in the parade and they win. It's a happy ending.
Will Frank Zappa be touring at 50?
It's only 3 years away. I don't know. Could.
Mm-hmm. What final thought would you like to leave with us?
Don't forget to register to vote. And after you vote, I mean, after you register, don't forget to vote. You know, make sure you play this again right around election time.
Frank, thank you very much. Thank you.